I want to welcome everybody to our virtual open house. Really, it's the first ever for St. Louis County having an event like this, but we thought it's really important for us to get the feedback, have that communication with the community. So that's why we're having it at this time. We're going to have about a 30-minute presentation, and then we're going to follow that up, just as Julie mentioned, with a Q&A session. You are encouraged to type in some comments as the presentation proceeds, but we're going to be answering most of the questions probably during the Q&A. This is our project team. I'll do some introductions. This is Steve Crassaway. He's the resident engineer for St. Louis County. He's actually in charge of the project overall, doing the design, and he'll be in charge of the construction. So if you have any questions about right-of-way issues, if you're adjacent to the project, or if you have any questions about construction schedules, or as the project proceeds, any updates, you're certainly welcome to contact Steve. His contact information will be available at the end of the presentation. My name is Vic Lund. I'm the traffic engineer for St. Louis County. And then I'm assisting Steve in the project development process. Taryn Erickson, she's the traffic engineer for the city of Duluth, my counterpart. She is also basically representing the city on the project since the intersection has four legs. Two of the legs are city streets and two of them are county roads. So it's a joint project between St. Louis County and city of Duluth. And finally, we have Andy Plowman. Andy, we're glad to have on our team. He is a consultant engineer with WSB and Associates, very knowledgeable on roundabout design. In fact, as a tidbit, Andy was the designer for the roundabout at Midway Road and Maple Grove Road in Hermantown. So that's his handiwork out there. Anyway, we're glad to have Andy on board. So next slide, Andy. All right, and do have patience with me. I'm gonna be asking Andy to flip through the slides just because there's a few animations we want to present, and just to make sure they operate smoothly, he's going to operate it from his computer. One other note I will mention is for the panelists, kind of some open housekeeping here. If any of the panelists have anything that they want to interject, feel free to do so. That'd be Steve, Taryn, or Andy. All right, let's get started. So with any project like this, it does require some time to prepare before you even can get to the point of construction. A project like this, 5 years is not uncommon to be planning, to be designing, to be preparing, all those sorts of things, right-of-way acquisition, permitting, to get ready for the project. And so St. Louis County, just to start off with the overview of what's really going on out here, St. Louis County has a project in 2022 to work on both Woodland Avenue and Snively Road. So let's talk about Woodland Avenue first, although that's not the subject of tonight's meeting, but it is tied to this project. So the plan is to resurface Woodland Avenue between Arrowhead Road and Anoka Street. That is a county road between Arrowhead and Anoka Street. Included in that project will be the replacement of those two traffic signals, one at Snively and the other at Arrowhead. And there is some lane configuration changes that we are working on. That design is still ongoing right now, but just FYI. The other is Snively Road. We're resurfacing Snively Road between Woodland and Glenwood. So really the question is why the focus on the intersection here? So think about it this way. Whenever we do a project, we want to ensure that the investment that is being made is credible, meaning that we're going to get the expected service life out of that investment. So early on in the project development of this project, we realized that there was some issues at that intersection. We wanted to just do some extra planning to see what was going on. We were aware of some congestion issues, especially in the morning. And so we commissioned between St. Louis County and Duluth a what's referred to as an intersection control evaluation study, or an ICE study. So basically what an ICE study does is it answers the question, what is the best traffic control strategy for the long term? And notice the word best, not perfect or not the right answer necessarily, but the best answer, because really in traffic engineering, it's a mix of balancing a lot of competing needs. We got issues of traffic safety we want to be concerned about, but bicyclists and peds, trucks, demand of vehicles, right-of-way constraints, project costs, all these things compete against each other. And really we're trying to find what is the best answer to that question. And so, right, I'll cut to the chase. The study did recommend a roundabout as the best alternative for the project, and I'll explain why, but basically it hinges on two points. traffic operations and traffic safety. So let's first go to the next slide. You'll see the this is a 2042 estimated turning movement volume summary by turning movement. And so as part of the study, when we actually did a traffic count, we have to forecast that into the future. Notice that I said earlier on in the presentation that we want to make sure this is functional for the long term, so that whatever we do today is going to be functional tomorrow. Another way to look at that is to say, well, there may not be an issue today, but is there something coming around the corner that we need to be prepared for? Because after all, as a wise use of public funds, we don't want to be remobilizing, chasing our tail on something into the future. Let's go to the next slide. So traffic operations, let's talk about that real quick. When we think about traffic operations, we have this phrase called level of service, or this metric called level of service, and we give it a letter grade just like school, A through F. And for design purposes, traffic engineers think of a D and above, so A through D, as generally acceptable. But when we look at level of service points and we start seeing E's and F's, those start raising some red flags in our mind. And those letter grades are tied to a delay number. That delay is an average delay for vehicles entering the intersection to complete their turning movement. Now, as an average, there's going to be some lower numbers and some higher numbers. So let's look at our focus on table five, and that's the existing operation today. That's the snapshot today of what's happening at the intersection. In the AM peak hour, we have a level of service F at about 100 seconds per vehicle. Now that means about a minute and a half, but there's some vehicles out there today that are experiencing upwards of 2.5 minutes of delay. Rolling those numbers into the future based upon the estimated traffic growth, we're looking at, if you look at table 7 out to 2042, you'll notice that now we're experiencing a level of service F in the PM hour as well. But notice those delay numbers. If you can see that, and it may be small on your screen, and I apologize, but now we're up to 330 seconds in the morning, 200 and some seconds in the afternoon. What this is telling us is that this intersection is kind of on the cliff, operationally speaking. It isn't going to take very much, many more vehicles to really push it over the edge, because the growth out there is not tremendous. I mean, we're talking 1% growth or something like that. But it's not going to take much growth to actually get us over that cliff, unfortunately. So this tells us the big first clue is that, hey, we have to do something. To do nothing is unacceptable from a traffic operation standpoint. And so then we can start comparing those alternatives. Really, we brought forth two options, a traffic signal and a roundabout. And for a roundabout, look at that. It's a level of service B in 2042. And for a traffic signal, it's a level of service C. So another clue. So it kind of gives us an idea that a roundabout may actually perform a little bit better than a traffic signal. Let's go to the next slide. So here's an animation showing existing demand out there, or volume, if you want to use that word. So we're going to run this animation. So go ahead and start that, Andy. So this animation, I'll talk you through it. This is actually showing, if you were to hover over the intersection, this is a random generation of vehicles to give you an idea of how the intersection is actually operating today in the morning commute. And notice that we're getting some queuing on the north leg by the church, but our largest queue is actually developing on Glenwood Street to the east. And so if we were to let this run, we're gonna basically see about a consistent traffic queue over that 1 hour. Let's go to the next slide. If we were to magically plop in a roundabout today, this is actually what we would be looking at. So let's run this animation. You'll notice one big difference between the roundabout and the always stop, and that is that there's no queuing developing. We're actually, as a serious joke, roundabouts are kind of like a toilet. I mean, they're actually flushing the vehicles through the intersection very efficiently. And again, look at that queuing on the east leg specifically. That was the worst, and we're just simply not seeing that queuing. This actually coordinates very well with what we observe in real life. Take, for example, and I'll mention this later, but the intersection of Midway Road and Maple Grove Road in Hermantown, we were having extensive queuing on the Maple Grove Road leg to the east of the intersection, and upwards of 1,000 feet in traffic queue on some of the worst days. And to date, we've not, at most, we've seen about a 2 to 3 vehicle queue, which is about 75 to 100 feet. So significant difference in operation between a roundabout and always stop. And really the biggest reason is that a roundabout allows vehicles to keep flowing, whereas an always stop, you have to stop and take turns between the approaches. Let's go to the next slide. So why a roundabout? So it does reduce delay. The other thing I want to mention too is that this intersection is what I would refer to as more of a suburban type intersection. What I mean by that is it's kind of on the perimeter or the ring of Duluth in Hermantown or the metro area. These types of suburban intersections really have high peak events, so a significant amount of traffic in the morning and the afternoon for commuting traffic. But the issue is that it's only for about 1 to 2 hours out of the day. So really for 22, 23 hours out of the day, it's not that bad. And so for those 2 to 3 hours out of the day that we have to think about that. So from a traffic, and this is where it comes into the question about the traffic signal or maybe why not a traffic signal. Traffic signals are very efficient at moving vehicles through an intersection during high demand or high traffic volume hours. Very efficient, but they are very inefficient when it comes to moving traffic through those low peak or low demand hours for those 22, 23 hours out of the day. What I mean by efficiency is imagine if you're in the mall area, maybe on Maple Grove Road on a side street coming up to Maple Grove, and let's say a late Sunday evening or something, you come up and there's a red light, but there's nobody approaching on Maple Grove Road. And you could have legitimately made a turning movement for the next 30 to 40 seconds as you're waiting for that red light to turn to a green. That is what was referred to as the inefficiency of a traffic signal. Whereas a roundabout, during those low volume times, you can just simply proceed into the roundabout and complete your turning movement without waiting. Let's go on. So the second issue is roundabout safety, or the safety is traffic safety issue. I'm very passionate about traffic safety. Maybe you've heard me talk about traffic safety before. We're gonna get into some of the nuts and details. I think it's important for us to dwell on this because we have heard some comments out there of the question, well, the safety performance doesn't necessarily seem that bad today, so why do we need to concern ourselves about this? Here's our perspective on that. As we showed earlier on, that the level of service is going to be a big issue going into the future for this intersection. We're right on that precipice before we start seeing some significant delaying out there. We're already at a level service F up there today. So a do nothing option is really out of the question here for the long term for the investment of the intersection. So we know we have to do something, and that's either a roundabout or a traffic signal. So the question about safety is not necessarily focused on the change in safety from today to the different strategy that we want to employ. The question is, what about the difference in safety between a traffic signal and a roundabout? Because frankly put, if you've observed that the safety performance is pretty good out there, you're pretty much right. And always stop, just so you know, is considered a traffic safety strategy, and it's been proven as such. And sometimes traffic engineers even use an always stop in rural environments to improve the safety of an intersection. So safety has actually been, performance has been quite well out there. But the difference between, if we were to go decide between a roundabout and a traffic signal, that's where the differences really start showing up. I'll put it this way. If you ask the question, where do most serious crashes within the cities of Duluth, Hermantown, and Proctor occur? So if you were to cut out the boundaries of Duluth, Hermantown, and Proctor, and focus just on crashes resulting in an injury or a fatality, and again, ask the question, where do they mostly occur? The answer to that first question is intersections. Okay, let's go to a second question. What type of intersection do those serious crashes generally happen at? Traffic signals. Interesting. So that means, as I've told people before in conversations about traffic safety, that if you're for driving around Duluth and Hermantown and Proctor, your greatest risk at being involved in a serious crash is probably going to be at a traffic signal. And some may ask, well, why at a traffic signal? Well, the type of crash that generally creates those serious type crashes are a right angle or a T-bone type crash. And by definition of a traffic signal, somebody's been running the red light. So when we look at roundabout performance in Minnesota, this is Minnesota data. We have in the previous map, you could see there was over 200 roundabouts in the state. I think we're over 300 now, actually. When we do before and after studies, we're showing upwards of 90% reductions in fatal and serious injury type crashes after the installation of a roundabout. And what that means is that if we were to choose between a traffic signal and a roundabout purely based upon the question of safety performance or the expected safety performance, it is very clear in the literature, it's very clear in our experience that a roundabout is the much safer option when it comes to that question. Let's go to the next slide. So real quickly on this is why are roundabouts safer versus traffic signals? Really, I'll put it this way. I can predict, generally speaking, the safety of an intersection by looking at or analyzing its conflict points. So what a conflict point is quite simple. If you took tracing paper, laid it over an intersection, and traced every legal path that a vehicle could take through the intersection, and then wherever one path crosses a separate path, put a dot right there. At a traditional intersection, that accounts for about 32 conflict points, which includes crosswalk points. So 32 conflict points, whereas roundabout has 8. So we know that a conflict point is where a crash could occur. So there's 32 opportunities for a crash in a traditional intersection, 8 opportunities for a crash in a roundabout. So just on that alone, we know that roundabouts probably are going to have fewer crashes. But the last thing I'll say about this is not all conflict points are created equal. Right angle or T-bone conflict points, there's only 4 of them in a traditional intersection, but those 4 generate the most of all serious crashes in those intersections. And so the point is we need to remove the right angle conflict points because just simply the physics of it, if you're involved in a T-bone crash, your body goes from 0 to 40, 0 to 50 miles per hour in the direction that the vehicle hits you at instantaneously. And simply put, our bodies are not designed to withstand that kind of trauma. And that's why we have a lot of internal issues when people are involved in those types of crashes that are very dangerous. And so that's really the objective from a traffic safety point of view is to remove those right angle conflict points. We're always going to have conflict points, but we really want to focus on removing those right angle conflict points. Let's go to the next slide. So what about pedestrian safety? There's been some, because of the increase of roundabouts in Minnesota, there's been some questioning on different advocates' part and different communities' parts on, well, are they okay for pedestrian safety? Really, what's going on there with pedestrians and roundabouts? Because after all, there's no push buttons, there's no pedestrian indications, there's no phasing that a pedestrian has for a walk phase. It's just more of a freewheeling kind of a thing. So what MnDOT did in 2018 is they had this study addendum they actually put onto an original study, and you can see the study on your screen there. So go ahead and Google it, that would be great. But basically what they did is they compared roundabouts to control intersections that they were similar intersections to the roundabout before, to what the intersection was before the roundabout. And so they're doing a comparison study, and they were finding that between the roundabout intersections and the comparison intersections, there's a 60% approximately reduction in pedestrian crashes, or there's 60% fewer crashes for involving pedestrians at the roundabouts versus those that were the comparison traditional type intersections. Let's go to the next slide. So really, why do pedestrians seem to have a better safety performance at roundabouts? I would suggest there's 3 issues going on. The first issue is the length of the crosswalk. If you look in the right-hand side of your screen, okay, on the, we'll look at the top picture of the right-hand side of your screen. You can see that crosswalk. It looks like a long crosswalk heading over to that far yellow color signal pole. That's probably about a 40 to a 50 foot crosswalk length. That's 40 to 50 feet of exposure that a pedestrian is exposed to versus in a roundabout. If you look on the left-hand side of the screen, you have about 12 feet of exposure for those crosswalk points. The second thing is that a crosswalk at a traditional intersection is experiencing multiple directions of traffic. So you have traffic going left and right, you have turning vehicles coming from the side street, either making a right or a left turn. So you have multiple directions of traffic that the pedestrian has to deal with. resident roundabout, the crosswalk is only on one direction at a time. And then the third thing is the proximity of the crosswalk to the intersection. So notice that the crosswalk at the traditional intersection or the signalized intersection is right at the intersection, which means that the driver has a lot higher mental load to deal with. They're dealing with the traffic signal. They're dealing with maybe waiting for a gap in traffic if they're making a left turn. Are there vehicles behind me? Is the signal about to turn yellow? Is it turning red? What's going on? On top of all of that mental load, now you have a pedestrian crosswalk right at the point where the vehicle or the driver is making that decision. If you look at a roundabout, for example, in the left-hand side picture, you can actually see this pretty well. This will be the top right picture of the roundabout slide portion. You'll notice that that crosswalk is set back from the main intersection or the roundabouts, which means that the driver task has been split up. So now it's just the driver and the pedestrian. And if there's no pedestrian, the driver proceeds to the roundabout, then it's just the driver looking for vehicles. So that's really, I think, the big difference between a roundabout and a traditional intersection for pedestrian safety. Let's go to the next slide. So bicycle accommodations. How can a bicycle navigate a roundabout? We designed something called a bike ramp or a slip ramp. And basically, a bicyclist can use a roundabout in two ways. By state law, as avid bicyclists know this, bicycles are treated as the same rights and privileges as a normal motor vehicle. So a bicyclist, if you're confident, if you're a type A bicycle personality, I'm not, but if you are, all the power to you, you can certainly ride through the roundabout in the driving lane just like a motorized vehicle. If you're like me and would be a little more cautious about that, then we provide these options for the bike to slip off onto the slip ramp. So you're coming along on the paved shoulder, you have a nice paved shoulder to ride on, and before that paved shoulder disappears, we introduce that slip ramp so you can just simply slip off onto the sidewalk. You can continue riding on the sidewalk, which is legal here, and then you can cross at the pedestrian crossing points to get to your turning movement or the direction that you're going to be intending to go as a bicyclist. It is recommended that you do disembark your bike when you're making that crossing maneuver at the pedestrian crossing, because really you're supposed to be treated as a pedestrian when you're crossing at those points. Let's continue. So truck accommodations. Can trucks go through roundabouts? Well, this can be controversial sometimes. I think truck drivers, and I can say this because I have a CDL Class A myself. I used to drive a dump truck in my previous life. Truck drivers can sometimes be opinionated, which is good. I appreciate that. And sometimes they may have had a bad experience in the past and were like, well, I don't think trucks can go through roundabouts. So I'll just put it this way. Just like any new discipline, roundabouts are generally new to the United States. I mean, maybe not so much anymore. We're at about, 30 years of experience in the U.S. for the most part for a modern roundabout, which, by the way, I'm using the word modern roundabout specifically because they are different from a rotary. They are different from a traffic circle. But early on, I would admit this, that maybe some of the roundabouts that were designed early on may have geometrically been deficient for accommodating trucks. But I will say this, that we have learned a tremendous amount as an industry, as a discipline, as engineers, and we have very sophisticated truck modeling algorithms and models that we can actually run trucks through, different types of trucks. So for example, maybe a single unit truck, like a furniture moving truck, maybe it's a tractor trailer type of combination where you'd see on the interstate highway. Maybe it's a truck with a low boy pulling a piece of heavy equipment. But in that case, they act similar on the horizontal or the XY coordinate, but they have a very short clearance between the low boy and the pavement. So you have to be aware of that as well. So all of those types of things we take into account and provide that ability for the truck to freely go through the intersection. In the slide, you'll note that there's a legend there. It says truck apron, pointing to a truck apron. It looks like a ring around the center island. Sometimes people have asked us, well, why do you have that concrete? Because it's typically made of concrete. Why do you have that concrete ring around that center island? It's for the off-tracking of a trailer from a truck. So, for example, if you're heading up north this coming weekend and going fishing and you're pulling a boat trailer, you're probably going to be a little hesitant to go through a drive-through. Why? Because you know that your boat trailer is going to off track from what your pet from what your pickup truck is. Well, the same thing is even emphasized on a accentuated on a truck where that trailer is offsetting quite a bit. if there is a significant offset, we give the tires an opportunity to roll up onto that truck apron so they don't have to climb up onto a curb. And we actually have an animation of this. If we go to the next slide, right here in Hermantown, at the Midway Road and Maple Grove Road intersection, the perspective here in the drone video, we'll go ahead and play this, but the perspective on the drone video is the drone is sitting in the southeast corner and kind of rotating towards the south and kind of pulling back out, you can see. But you can notice that there's a truck going into the roundabout right now, and that would be a typical tractor-trailer combination that we would use for the interstate for a model. And you notice that that trailer didn't even, the tires of the trailer did not even touch the truck apron. So it can be quite successful that way. And interesting to note too is we think about trucks. At this roundabout specifically, this is a route that was used by a company that was constructing a windmill farm out in South Dakota last year. And it was the route for transporting the windmill components from the Duluth port to South Dakota. And they were coming down south on Midway Road to get to I-35. And actually what they did, is they had windmill blades that were 235 feet long. That's not including the truck cab, and that's not including the end of the trailer. We're talking about 275 feet in total length. And what they did is, actually, this is a good view. We're looking directly north here, is a truck would be coming at us in this view, coming southbound. And they actually moved over to the northbound lane, so the lane on our right, and went through the roundabout that way completely fine. I mean, it took them about 3 to 4 minutes to get through the roundabout, but the point being is that the roundabout in itself did not prohibit this from being a oversized load route. In fact, it still is functioning as an oversized load route, and it seems to be just fine that way. We'll go to the next slide. Bus accommodations. This we'll start this animation, but this roundabout is actually down near the Twin Cities, I believe, but is adjacent to a school, and we're going to see some buses coming out, I think, from our left, using the roundabout itself as well. And we have a bus making a left turn or continuing around the roundabout, I suppose. Technically, there's no left turns in a roundabout, but I think you know what I mean. And you can see that those buses on the very far right hand side of your screen are not even driving up on the center on that truck apron. So they're actually able to go through the roundabout just as easily as a passenger vehicle. So let's continue. So just to give you an example of what we did at Midway Road and Maple Grove Road, the top picture is the before and the bottom picture is the after. The top picture north is to the top, and the bottom picture north is kind of to your lower left. And this intersection, the reason why I wanted to showcase this is a high speed intersection. So the posted speed limit on Midway Road is 55 miles per hour. Although we've done numerous speed studies out there, and the prevailing speed of most vehicles is actually between 60 and 65 miles per hour. So plopping a roundabout onto that intersection where it was the side street stop control, so only Maple Grove had to stop before, Midway Road did not stop before. We introduced something that now Midway Road traffic has to slow down for every single time they come into that intersection. We're not aware of any serious crashes that have occurred at the intersection. In fact, I'm only aware of one crash right now, which occurred about three months after it opened. It was a vehicle on the side street did not yield for the vehicle in the circulatory lane. It was a property damage bumper crash only. There was no injuries as far as I'm aware, but that's the only crash that I'm aware of at the intersection. Before the roundabout, we were averaging about 2 to 3 crashes per year. And so since then, if that crash that I'm aware of is the only crash, that means we're averaging less than one crash, closer to 0.5 crashes per year. So significant improvement on traffic safety overall for that intersection. Plus, again, accommodates trucks, and operationally, look at that bottom picture onto your left is Maple Grove Road, the leg going to the east. That leg right there was where we were experiencing tremendous queue lengths, our lineup of traffic, and we have not witnessed anything at all queuing up on that leg anymore. Literally, I've actually told Steve Crassaway, it's like, we're sure that there's the same amount of vehicles entering the intersection as before, right? And the answer is yes. In fact, we have data to prove it. It's just that when you stand at the intersection, you hardly see any vehicles. So it has the appearance of that the number of traffic vehicles has actually gone down. But in actuality, what's happening out there is it's so efficient at moving traffic, you rarely see a vehicle at the intersection. Let's continue. So again, why not a traffic signal? I mentioned the two major points are traffic operations is not that's the driver for this project, is we know that we're on the precipice of having significant failure in terms of congestion and delay at the intersection. And we know that a do nothing option is really not an alternative for the long term. And so then the question becomes, from a safety standpoint, well, what is the best option safety performance wise, a traffic signal or a roundabout? Clearly it's a roundabout. And we'll look at this one other perspective real quick, is a roundabout confusing to drive through? Well, what we did is we actually put together a list of all the rules that you are supposed to follow and be aware of as you navigate a traffic signal. So this screen is actually showing all the rules and the steps that you would have to take when you navigate a traffic signal. So in this case, this list is showing 12 different items. Let's go to the next slide. And here's your list for the roundabout. Yield to traffic already in the roundabout. So basically, the traffic in the roundabout circulates in a counterclockwise direction. And so the vehicle in the circulatory lane has the right of way. And so the vehicle on the sides, on one of the legs approaching the roundabout, has to wait for the traffic to clear out from the roundabout from their left. So the driver's looking to their left. And when there's no vehicle approaching from the left in the circulatory right lane, that driver can actually proceed into the roundabout. Actually, for people that get used to these roundabouts over time, you'll notice that the behavior people are quick learners. You'll notice that people don't even stop, won't even come to a near stop at all, because when they realize that there's nobody in the roundabout, they'll just proceed right into the roundabout at about 15, 18 miles per hour. And again, it's extremely efficient once you learn that operation. Let's continue. And continuing with this theme of why not a traffic signal, again, roundabouts work very well in both low volume and high volume conditions. They're efficient in both aspects. Traffic signals are very inefficient on those low demand, low volume hours, which are again about 22, 23 hours out of the day. But they are efficient for that 1 to 2 hours. And again, the crash issue, traffic signals are not safety. Traffic signals are not safety devices. I want that to sink in. Traffic signals are not safety devices. I've heard it requested of me before. Well, we have a safety issue. We need to put in a traffic signal or put in a traffic light. And again, we have to be very cautious when we think about that from a safety standpoint. Traffic signals sometimes are the best answer. The intersection of Rice Lake Road and West Arrowhead Road, for example, St. Louis County is completing a project as we speak. And we actually did a formal analysis on should we put a roundabout there. Simply put, the analysis strongly suggested that a roundabout is not the best solution at that intersection of Rice Lake Road and West Arrowhead Road by the Holiday gas station. And so sometimes a traffic signal is the best answer, but in this case, it does clearly seem to be that the roundabout is the best answer. Let's go on. A couple of details, we're just going to finish up with a few details about the project, proposed project, and then we'll go right into our Q&A. So we're almost done here. This is a schematic showing what the landscaping may look like. This is actually the latest edition of the proposed landscaping. The idea is to have a Lake Superior theme with balsam fir and paper birch. And then for the grass, we're planning to have a no maintenance or a low maintenance grass that's it's called a no-mow turf. So it's a short growth grass. In the inner third of the center island, we're proposing large boulders, so about 4 to 6 feet in diameter. And then in the outer two-thirds, we're proposing about, smaller cobble rock, maybe 1 to 2 feet in diameter, maybe 3 feet at the most, in the outer two-thirds. We'll go on. And one other thing, as I it just hit me as the slide was transitioning, We are planning to put in two conduits to the center island. They'll be empty, but they would allow for future electrical power and future water if there was ever a choice from the city of Duluth or somebody else to say, hey, we want to have more of a formal landscaping theme. We would always have that opportunity to run power and water if we wanted to. All right, construction staging. So here's kind of what we're thinking about for how this roundabout would be constructed. And actually, again, we actually went through quite an extensive analysis on this. It may seem simple on the surface, but actually gets pretty deep pretty quick. So we're planning to construct the roundabout in two stages. Stage one is we would work on the east leg, so the Glenwood Street east leg, and construct the new south leg. Notice that this new south leg actually has kind of an S curve to it. We have to introduce that S curve on the south leg really for the geometry to work for the vehicles to enter into the roundabout. But the idea underneath stage one is construct the east leg and the new south leg. But this would allow us to maintain traffic on Jean Duluth Road, Snively Road, and Glenwood Street West. For that duration, we're thinking about 1 month, maybe a little over a month for this stage. This would be the first aspect of the project. And we'll go to stage two. And on stage two, we are looking at be a full closure. At some point, we have to do a full closure. It's kind of like pulling a tooth. At some point, you just have to do it. And in this case, it would be about a six week duration. And we'll show the detour in the next slide. But as the next slide is transitioning, I do want to mention just real quick about the project cost and how that is planning to work. So as I mentioned at the beginning, this is a joint project between St. Louis County and the City of Duluth. Because there's four legs, two of them are county, two of them are city. So there's going to be a 50-50 cost share between St. Louis County and the City of Duluth. Some comments that we've heard already are folks concerned about, is this the right use of expenditure for the City of Duluth? Because there's a lot of other streets or routes in the city proper that maybe could be have some work on them or something. Understand that the majority of the funding out here at this project is going to be federally funded. So most of it is not going to be from state aid or local tax dollars for St. Louis County or Duluth, but most of it is going to be federally funded. And number two, also understand that the roadway network in Duluth is separated by three different jurisdictions. So we have state highways, we have county highways, and we have city streets. And so when we talk about funding, state of Minnesota can only spend trunk highway dollars on the trunk highway system. They can't spend money on a county road or a city street. Same for the county and the city. Whereas the county, we're restricted to invest dollars only on county roadways, and the city is restricted to only investing dollars on the city streets. So there is a difference in jurisdiction, which is why it isn't possible to take the dollars for this project and reallocate them to another part of the city, wherever that may be. Again, because number one, it's federally funded, and number two, the dollars are allocated to a county road. All right, so back to the detour question. So this is a schematic showing the proposed detour for Glenwood Street. So this detour would go into effect during stage one, and the proposed routes for this detour are starting at the east side, so 43rd Avenue East, dropping down to Superior Street, over to Hawthorne, up to 4th Street, and then up to Wallace, and then a little jog of East Arrowhead Road, and then to you're ultimately back at Woodland Avenue. This detour would be utilized for the entire duration of the project because it would be in place for both stage one and stage two. So we'll go to the next slide showing the detour for Jean Duluth and Snively Road. And so this detour, as proposed, would utilize Woodland Avenue and Martin Road. Just so everybody understands about that jurisdictional thing, Martin Road is entirely county. Woodland Avenue is county between Snively Road and Calvary Road. Actually, the county segment actually begins at Arrowhead Road, but on the schematic, what's being highlighted, it's county between Snively and Calvary. and then a City of Duluth street on Woodland between Calvary and Martin Road. So we'll continue. Here's the best project schedule that we can share to date. So currently we're in August 2020. It's a 2022 project, so we've got a couple years yet. Just actually, summer's gone pretty fast. So now we're just slightly under 2 years already. It's pretty amazing to think about that already. In fact, I hate to mention it, but I have a maple tree in my backyard that it may turn a little bit early, but I hate to admit that there's already some color in my maple tree in my backyard. Anyway, back to a positive note. So we're in right-of-way negotiation. This will last about a year. So this is for permanent easement and temporary easement. So if you live adjacent to the project limits and there's some right-of-way impact on your property, we will be reaching out to you in the next, you know, starting right now through the end of, through next year, next summer, and working with you on acquisition of whatever right-of-way is necessary. There will be, again, permanent easement and temporary easement. Difference between those real quick, a permanent easement is where the county actually purchases the land or the easement, I should say, to be used in perpetuity. So it's always dedicated to the road. And then a temporary easement is really used for those areas where we need to blend back from the project into an existing grade or something, let's say your front yard. And so temporary easement is just used for the project only. And then once the project is completed, you retain full rights of your original property before the project was even started. Final design, again, we're still working on that right now. We have the conceptual layout, but now we're moving into final design, which is about 60% of the design work yet to do. Right about 30, 40% of the design work done thus far. That'll be through November of 2021. We're hoping to bid the project, open for bids in winter of 2021-2022, hopefully December 2021 or maybe January 2022 to see how that proceeds. But really that gives us the opportunity to get the best unit prices for the project. That's the best time of year to let a project. Construction is anticipated as starting in June 2022 and hopefully to be completed in August of 2022. Notice our intention here is that we would start the week after school is released in June. So it's typically the first week of June is the last week of school. So we would start the following week or the first Monday after school is released or done. And then our intention is that we would complete the project by the end of August. You know, school typically starts the Monday after Labor Day. So we would intend to have the intersection open before school starts that following fall. Let's continue. All right, so here's some project contact information. Again, Steve Crassaway is the primary contact. If you want to contact me, you're certainly welcome to do so. I forgot to put my contact information up there, but I will give you my phone number and email. So it's pretty easy to remember, but my phone number is 625-3873. That number again, 625-3873. And my email address is lundv, L-U-N-D-V, at the same domain name that Steve Crassaway has for his email address. The project website is up and running, obviously, you're aware of that. So there's really two ways for you to participate. There's the Q&A, and again, we encourage you to participate in that tonight, but also on the website. You can submit comments on the website. There's an interactive map that you can actually swipe back and forth to kind of see how the new intersection would look overlaid on the existing intersection. And there's also an interactive map for you to add annotations and comments to the map itself. So let's say you are looking at the roundabout and you're like, yeah, I have a specific question or a comment about this specific area of the proposed roundabout. And you can actually make that comment or that in that way on the website. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to Julie. So she will give us some last minute instructions. If you want to participate verbally, you will be able to do that. And so in terms of how this will flow, so there'll be two ways for asking questions. You can type in a comment on the chat box, or you can raise your hand to speak. And again, Julie will give instructions on how to do that. So we'll continue with the Q&A as long as necessary. Again, we're here to listen to your comments. We want to hear your input, and we're also here to answer any questions or comments you may have as well. And if I can't answer the question, we have some other knowledgeable people out there. Andy Plowman, Steve Crassaway, and Taryn Erickson will also assist if necessary in answering questions. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Julie. Julie?
Great. Thank you, Vic. Everybody, first of all, I did send you Vic's phone number and email address that he just gave us verbally in the chat. So if you do need to reach him, you can find it there. Like he said, we will take questions, a couple ways to ask them. Like we talked about at the beginning of the meeting, feel free to continue using that Q&A option. We have had a number of questions asked through that Q&A panel throughout the meeting, and they've been answered there. So you can go ahead and find that Q&A. Again, it is a question mark inside of a square. You can find it in the icons at the bottom of your screen. To open that, you can see questions that have already been asked and their answers, and continue to ask questions there. As promised, also, if you would prefer to ask your question verbally, there are instructions on the screen right now for how to use the hand raise. Now, unfortunately, the hand raise might be in a few different places, kind of depending on how you have joined us tonight. So we've tried to lay those all out here so that you're able to find them. Again, so use those images wherever it is. It will literally look like a hand. And if you click on it, it's going to raise your hand and we'll be able to call on you. You do just want to make sure that you are somehow connected to the audio. So if you have a computer with a microphone embedded, make sure you have that connected. If you have joined us over the phone, make sure that you have your phone ready and connected, and we will take questions again using either the Q&A or that hand raise. Okay, Jim, I see you are trying to ask a question. Jim Dombrowski, I'm going to go ahead and unmute you.
Thank
You
you.
should be unmuted here, so go ahead and ask your question.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, great. Hi, good afternoon, everybody. I live right on Snively Road, and late last fall, there was an initiative to change the zoning across the street on I guess that would be the east side of Snively. Will there be any additional roads or access cut into that area now that it's zoned for multiple family dwelling?
So this is Vic. I'm going to, I apologize, I can't answer that directly because I'm not intimately familiar with the city zoning. Maybe Taryn, if you have any information, or maybe you could redirect him to find out the answer for that question.
I do not have any information on that. I would suggest talking with our planning department, or if you wanted to send me an email, I can try to find an answer for you and follow up with you after this meeting.
Thank you. So for the residents who live along Snively or any of the streets that are going to be kind of chopped up, will we continue to have access even though the road is closed? Will we have it up to our driveway, or how does that work?
So in the construction contract documents, and I'm going to let Steve answer your question too, but typically we do require the contractor to maintain access to all businesses and residents, but more so specifically residents, because at the end of the day, you have to get there. There may be some times where that's not totally possible. I'll let Steve jump in there on that one.
Yeah, Vic, this is Steve. Yeah, you're exactly correct. That people will always be able to get to their house. You know, which direction they go may change based on the detour or the day, but we'll be working with the people that are directly in the construction area daily to make sure that they know what to do. And one of the things I should mention too, because both of you people live in the area, is that the G Duluth Road should be open tomorrow night. So you'll be able to get up to Martin Road beginning tomorrow night. We're done with our construction of all the bridges.
Okay, we do have a couple more hands here. So we will start with Leah. Leah, I am unmuting you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for your thought and for your presentation on the roundabout. I've also gotten some wonderful answers from one of your presenters, but I'm curious, you talk about safety. There's that safety lights, do not, there's been a lot of thought given to the wait times for commuters that move through this community. What I'm really worried about, and I think the true safety issue for this road is the speed. People do not follow the speed, and if you increase the flow of the quicker flow of traffic, I'm worried that that is going to impact the safety for those that live on this road, including non-humans. We've already seen animals hit, and could the money be used to enforce the 30 mile per hour speed limit, since this is a residential road besides a county and a city road? I know that was very confusing with a lot of information, but I have a huge concerns about the safety of all of the movement that takes place on the road, not just those that get from point A to point B.
Thank you very much, Leah, for that question. Actually, that's a great question. Is what is the interaction between the roundabout or a roundabout and speeds on the approaching legs to a roundabout? Just as I mentioned before, obviously one of the positive benefits of a roundabout is it delays congestion and allows a more free flow operation for traffic. What that does not translate into, though, is influencing the speed of the vehicles approaching the intersection. We've not observed anywhere, even for our direct experience in St. Louis County, we've constructed two roundabouts, one up in the city of Chisholm and one here in Hermantown. And we have not observed any increase in vehicle speeds or changes in vehicle speeds for that matter for the approaching legs. Really, the only thing the roundabout will have an effect on is the operation at the intersection. But in terms of the question of speeding on the road, I presume you're referring to, you mentioned 30 miles per hour, so it must be either Glenwood Street or Snively Avenue, is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. So speeding in itself is, I have to temper myself. I could actually have hours of lecture here, which I could do, but I'm gonna restrain myself. But speeding is a whole different topic, but really, we have posted speed limits, we have the influence of enforcement, and really, I'll just put it this way, in Minnesota law, the 30 mile per hour is the lowest speed limit available for county roads. Actually, the law was recently changed for cities and how that is governed, but really 30 miles per hour is the floor for the most part. And so because we have no option of modifying the speed limit, we're kind of looking at, you'd have to rely more on an enforcement. So there's different tools, there's engineering tools, there's enforcement tools. The other thing I'll mention out there too, real quick, is I've personally done as a traffic engineer, I've done dozens and dozens and dozens of speed studies. And what I'm going to say, I say absolutely respectfully, but I just understand where I'm coming from in terms of my practice and my experience as a traffic engineer. Oftentimes I'll get a phone request about concern about speeds on a county roadway. And so we'll go out and actually do the speed study. In every instance I've done this, I find the same exact results, which are that for the most part, 80 to 90% of all vehicles on that roadway of question or concern are driving a reasonable speed, and what we would all consider a reasonable speed. I call it the 10% rule, where about 10% of the drivers are driving in excess of what they should be or in excess of the posted speed limit. And frankly, maybe they should have their driver's license suspended for a while. It's those folks that we're concerned about, right? But the vast majority that I've always found in a study are driving the speed limit or a reasonable speed for the roadway. And so again, it's that 10% rule. So that really is the challenge from an engineering standpoint, is how do we get the 10% of folks to slow down, to become more responsible? Because at the end of the day, you're exactly right from a traffic safety standpoint. You're driving a 2,000 to 5,000 pound object. that is not easily stopped, and people can become seriously injured or killed, and it is a serious task. And so that's one of the driving culture aspects that I've been involved in terms of conferences and meeting with people, is getting that word out that, hey, driving is a serious task and we need to be aware of that and changing that driver culture. And so we're doing our best at St. Louis County, and I know Duluth is doing it as well. With the Duluth Police Department has been a leader on TZD towards zero deaths. But yeah, it's a challenging thing. Unfortunately, I can't offer a bulletproof or a silver bullet solution tonight. Speeding, unfortunately, will always be an issue. There's ways to mitigate it, but there's a certain subset of our drivers out there, about 10%, that generally have a difficulty with speeding.
Thank you.
Okay, next we are going to go to Todd. Todd, you can go ahead. Todd, are you with us? All right, we don't seem to have Todd connected. Todd, if you come back and you can hear us, go ahead and send a message and let us know. Any more questions people would like answered? Again, feel free to use that Q&A or go ahead and use the hand raise to ask verbally.
Hey, this is Jim.
Yep, Jim, go ahead.
So snow removal, we do get a fair amount of snow. Does the snow itself and snow removal impact a roundabout? I have no idea.
This is Vic. That's a great question. That's actually before we constructed our roundabout up in Hermantown, we had actually met with from a distance, and that was pre-COVID, but whatever. We'd met with a distance. It was a city down in the Twin Cities, and I apologize, I forget the name of the city. Andy Plowman probably remembers, but anyway, the city has probably some of the largest numbers of roundabouts on their jurisdiction in the state of Minnesota. And so we asked the question to them, how do you deal with snow removal? And we'd never dealt with it before prior to 2018. And so they gave us some reassuring information about that. And so we've had two winters of experience on plowing roundabouts here right in Hermantown. And it's really no different than plowing a traditional intersection. You're always going to have a windmill of snow, even in a traditional intersection that's left over. And so the plow has to come back on their route. And so typically what would happen is we would have maybe two plows, one that, intersect the routes between two plows, and one snow plow maybe wings out the recirculatory roadway, and then another plow comes in and clears off one of the approaches, and it's kind of take turns clearing snow that way. But that's kind of how we do it with a traditional intersection. So if you can picture snow removal in a traditional large signalized intersection, it's actually quite similar to a roundabout.
Doesn't Hibbing have a roundabout right by the McDonald's at 169 and whatever that other highway is?
Yep, it's 169, Trunk Highway 37, and right next to the McDonald's for sure. And that is a roundabout, yep. And there is one up in Chisholm as well, so right next to the McDonald's in Chisholm. So there's something about McDonald's apparently with roundabouts. If McDonald's is listening tonight, maybe you want to think about building a McDonald's out there. But yeah, so up in Chisholm is Trunk Highway 73 at County Highway 5. There's a church right on the corner. It's right next to the Iron Man statue. And that's been out in operation since 2017. Both the Hibbing and the Chisholm roundabouts were constructed in the same year, 2017. I will mention too, just in terms of future roundabout projects. So we're talking about the intersection of Jean Duluth, Snively, and Glenwood tonight. St. Louis County and MnDOT are actually partnering on two additional roundabout projects going, looking into the future. One is, I believe it's the year 2024 at the intersection of US 2, Highway 2, and Trunk Highway 194 out in Saginaw. It's kind of like a weird skewed intersection. It's unfortunately been the site of serious crashes and fatalities. So if you're familiar with the intersection of Highway 2, Highway 194, Saginaw Road, that will be a roundabout. And also in 2023, I believe, the intersection of Trunk Highway 37, so Highway 37 and Highway 7 up just south of Eveleth up on the Iron Range, that will also be a roundabout as well. So both of those roundabout projects actually are safety driven, because of those intersections have a very, very, very poor safety performance. Again, but this intersection we talked about tonight, it's more of an operation driven, but those are a safety driven project.
Will we have increased taxes, property taxes for this?
No. This project is federally funded, and for the local share on the county side, we're using state aid dollars. State aid dollars for the county are from the vehicle registration fees and gas tax. But it's gas tax and registration fees generated in Minnesota is where the state aid dollars come from. And same for City of Duluth, if they're using state aid dollars for their local share, that would also come out of the same pot of money at the state of Minnesota. So basically, as far as I understand, this project is driven 100% by the fuel tax, both the federal and state fuel tax, and Minnesota state registration fees. So no, your property taxes will not be affected by this directly.
All right, we're going to try going to Todd again here and see if we can get him connected. Todd, you should be unmuted and able to speak now. Todd, are you able to unmute and turn on your microphone here? All right, we still don't seem to be able to get Todd connected here. Any other questions from anyone?
Maybe I'll, I don't know if Andy or Steve or Taryn has anything to say. Maybe I'll, and I don't want to put you guys on the spot, but if you have anything, you're welcome to add to anything too as well.
All right, hearing nothing from any other, oh, did I hear someone here? No, okay. Hearing nothing from any other panelists and not seeing any more questions coming through, do just want to remind everyone that if you do have further questions, you can contact Steve or Vic using their email addresses or phone numbers. There's the slide. So there's your contact information if you do have further questions. Otherwise, if there's nothing further to add, I think we can go ahead and say goodnight to everybody.
Well, thank you very much, everybody. This is Vic Lund again, traffic engineer of St. Louis County. I thank you very much for showing up. Looks like I can see our attendee list starting to precipitously drop here, which I think means everybody's feels like the meeting is kind of coming to an end. But thank you so much for joining us tonight. And just as Julie mentioned, we have a couple ways for us to contact us through the website, as well as you can see some contact information here. We're going to all sign off now, and we wish you a great evening. And again, thank you for joining us.